if somebody is an ilalim ng thermocline. So that's very important in determining possible submarine passages and submarine parking areas. And I'm very sure that China is very interested in that for possible submarine operations in the future. It can also do hydrographic survey to detect oil, gas, and minerals. So they're finding out what is under, what is there below in Vietnam Rice, 30 million hectares. Now, the other thing is, what is the strategic, the geopolitical significance of Vietnam Rice? And here I'd like to introduce you to the term of first island chain and second island chain. The first island chain is this imaginary line from Borneo, going up north along Palawan, this Palawan, and passing through this passage called Pasir Channel between Taiwan and Batanes, Philippines, and then going all the way to Japan. This is the second island chain from the Papua New Guinea area, going up to Guam, up to Japan. Now, what is the significance there? Right now, the first island chain is that imaginary line that restricts the movement of China. Ito ang China, no? Most of their power projection is limited within the first island chain. And being an emerging power, they would like to be able to break out and project their power much farther, all the way to Guam, the Western Pacific area. The other powers, Japan, US, Australia, would like China to stay here. And in fact, they don't even want China to be dominant in the South China Sea. And China would like to break out, and that's exactly what they're doing. That's why they're developing in a very fast pace their navy and their air force. They want to elbow out the 7th Fleet of the United States. There. Second island chain. You know what happened in the 90s? There was a showdown in the Taiwan area, and China was demonstrating the capability to invade Taiwan. So what the US did was they sent a 2 aircraft carrier task force here, plus an amphibious assault ship that stopped China. But China learned a lesson from that, that it's very important to have the Navy in order to project the power. So they started developing the Navy as a result of that. Now, realignments are happening. You've been reading about some announcements coming from the President with respect to relationship with the US, announcements with respect to Philippine relationship with China and even Russia. And in my opinion, it's hard to tell what's going to happen in the next 5 years, or even 10 years, when geopolitical and geostrategic forces will continue to bear on the Philippines. We happen to be strategically located here. This is the first island chain, second island chain. The Philippines is here. And China succeeds through skillful diplomacy, through soft power. When I say soft power, giving credits, giving grants, giving assistance, or hard power, using their coast guard, using their air force, using their navy, to get the Philippines as their ally, then they can immediately jump and break out of the South China Sea. Because right now, the Philippines, as you can see, is a barrier. Taiwan is here, Japan is here, the Philippines is here. It is a barrier that prevents China from breaking out. But if the Philippines chooses to become an ally of China, then China will be able to jump over, and this will now become their point or they can start projecting their power. And one way of doing that is by having control in Benham Rice area. Benham Rice is deep. Some parts, most parts are about 1,000, 2,000 meters. But there are some portions of Benham Rice that are shallow, 30 meters up to 55 meters. And they have the capability to get construct in those areas. So the game plan then is of course the control of the sea lines of communications, SLOC, which is very important in naval strategy, to control the sea lines. They might that will enable them to construct structures at sea. Last year, we're very fortunate that the U.S. donated a surface ship to the Philippines. Now, we are paying Gregorio Velasquez, so we can use this to survey Benham Rice. And then also, Japan turned over to the Philippines 5 TC-90 propeller light planes that can be used for research and surveillance also, surveillance aircraft. But we should be alarmed because China wants permission to survey Benham Rice according to the Department of Foreign Affairs. And I'm surprised that the OIC of the DFA, when he made an announcement, said that that was being considered. And my opinion is that it should not be considered at all, that it should be rejected outright. And they said also that China is open to marine research operations in the Philippines in the Benham Rice area. Again, another warning signal. We should be very careful about this. Indeed, because of that, the Philippines is facing a security challenge in two fronts. And what happens in the coming years or the decades will impact the balance of power in the Asia-Pacific area and beyond. And things can change, again, because of several considerations. It could be because of the skillful diplomacy of China, or use of soft power, or the use of hard power, the same way they grabbed Scarborough Shoal, same way they grabbed the Mississippi River. So the Lord would like to thank you for this allowing me to give you this briefing so that you can fully appreciate and realize the strategic and security significance of what's happening right now in the West Philippine Sea, the South China Sea, with Scarborough as the principal area of concern, and what's happening in the east part of the Philippines with Benham Rice as the primary source of concern. Thank you very much. Thank you.
China and Russia. You have to look at the history.
China and Russia. They used to be bitter enemies. In fact, they were almost on the verge of war because of the Iran border incident. And then everybody knows that Vietnam is an adversary of China. In South China Sea, also they had a land war in 1979. But despite that, Russia is the main supplier of strategic arms of Vietnam. Vietnam has Sukhoi 27. Vietnam ordered an additional 6 Sukhoi 30 fighter jets. They acquired 6 submarines, kilo class submarines that can wreak havoc on the PLA Navy in the South China Sea. They are using Russian surface to air missiles, some the S-300 and I think even the S-400. But of course, Russia is playing. That's why there's this naval exercise. But on the other hand, Russia doesn't have a very strong navy. Their navy is considered very backward compared to the navy of Japan, of the US, and also of China. But still, we don't know the strategic agenda of President Putin, because he's also very much preoccupied in the Middle East, in Crimea, in the Black Sea. So, to me, the principal concern here would be the capability of China, because China is building up their navy in a very fast pace. But this has triggered a number of other activities by other countries. This is already an arms race. Japan ordered 42 F-35 fighter planes, the most modern in the world today. And when they complete the order, they already have 4. When they complete the order, they will have dominance in that part of the world. China will have nothing to match. And then you can see the coalition between US and Australia, the coalition between Japan and the US. And now, the tripartite coalition emerging among India, US, and Japan. Not only this out in the Indian Ocean, because this Malabar exercise that I mentioned to you, 1 year they're in the Indian Ocean, another year they're in the Pacific area for exercises. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.